Good afternoon, one and all. A very warm welcome to everyone present here. Hope you are having a great day and congratulations on your JEE Advanced result. So this JEE preparation journey takes a lot of perseverance. And with this virtual education conclave by Tech Facility Bombay, we wish to bring you the information tools to satisfactorily conclude the journey by choosing the right technical stream and college for you. So keep your questions handy. We'll be starting in 2 minutes. So, all right, let's get started without any ado. Hello, everyone. I'm Adit Agrawal. And welcome to the fifth session of Virtual Ed Conclave at TechFest IIT Bombay, which is the Asia's largest science and technology festival. And before you all become engineering students and get to attend this in person, let's have a look at its after movie.
You are right. You are live.
Yeah. That was the marvelous after movie for TechFest 1920. Now let's dive into the session now and introduce you to the esteemed speaker for this afternoon. So Professor Ravi Kumar NV is a professor at Metallurgical Engineering Department and also the head of the department at IIT Madras. He has various awards and recognitions, and you know he is involved in many research projects. So I'll mention you some of the awards which he's received. So one of this is Institute Research Development Award under 40 years category, IRDA 2015 from IIT Madras in recognition of excellence in research at IIT Madras in 2015. He also received the Young Faculty Recognition Award, which is also known as YFRA from IIT Madras in recognition of excellence in teaching and research in 2012. So welcome, sir, and thank you for being a part of the IIT Conclave. And now I'll hand it over to you.
Thank you. Thank you for the introduction, and let me thank all the student team for inviting me to this session. It's a great pleasure to interact with all of you. Without wasting any more time, what I will do is I'll spend some time, close to 20-25 minutes, giving a flavor of the field of metallurgical and materials engineering. And after that, I think I will have another 30 minutes possibly, and I'll take all the questions that students may have. To answer them and to clarify any questions that they may have. So I'll share my presentation. So when you see, maybe you get more clarity. So let me just share my screen. Confirm if you're able to see my screen.
Sir. It is visible.
Yeah. So let me go to the presentation mode. Okay. Fine. So again, my name is Ravi Kumar. I'm a professor of ceramics and I head the laboratory for high performance ceramics in IIT Madras. I'm also currently the head of the department, and I also head the Central X-ray Diffraction Lab. I've been working in IIT Madras for the last 15 years. Let me just go through some slides which will give you a flavor of the field. And even before that, let me just show you one slide which actually, when I was doing my postdoctoral research in the US, one of my postdoctoral boss was describing how research is governed and what governs research. And he told me, and he was discussing with me, that everybody on earth, irrespective of whether you are a materials engineer or a mechanical engineer or an electric engineer or a computer science engineer, you all will focus on some more important aspects of energy, environment, and security. And all the more it is more relevant to materials. That's what I have realized in the meanwhile. So if you just look at the field of materials, most of us would be working in the area of security. Security means we would be working on materials for space, defense, and so on. Or we'll be working on materials for energy, like energy storage materials, energy producing materials, and so on. Or we would be working on materials for environment. And I have put something at the center, which is called healthcare. So this is something which is new. Several of us in many other IITs also focus on healthcare. People work on biomedical materials, which also has a very important role in the current day scenario. So I would summarize most of our research to be focusing and coming under these three categories or four categories. And again, let me just take you through some of the wonder materials which actually inspired me as well. I was having a conversation with a German who works for a company. And the company is located in Ulm. The company name is called Zwick, which manufactures mechanical testing equipment. And we have, of course, purchased some of the mechanical testing equipment from them. So when I was having a conversation with him, he alerted me that the Guardian magazine has come out with an article which talks about some five wonder materials that could change the world. And when he told me this some 4 or 5 years back, I immediately went to the Guardian article. The article published in Guardian, and it was a very nice article, which I thought I'll share that with you because it is very inspiring. And this article starts with the fact that one of the statements made by one of the scientists from the University of College at London, Professor Mark Miodonik, who says that the history of materials is a history of mistakes. It's a very interesting statement because most of the materials discovery, according to him, happened accidentally or by mistakes. And although that might have been the case for centuries, people have now moved on to more developing materials and designing materials in a more systematic way. So now in modern times, we design materials using computers, computational algorithms, and so on. In fact, in recent times at IIT Madras, we even hired a material scientist who works in one of the national laboratories in the US. He works on machine learning techniques, whose idea is basically to develop new materials using machine learning techniques. So the idea of developing new materials has changed from what people used to call as developing materials by a botched experiment to a much more systematic way of designing materials using computers and designing algorithms to design new materials and so on. So we have moved quite a bit in designing materials, and sometimes the materials can be so new that the applications may still be very tentative, and we might be still wondering where to use them. And one of the first wonder materials that this Guardian reported was graphene. I think some of you might have already heard of graphene. In fact, when I was doing my PhD at the Max Planck Institute in Stuttgart, that was a time when people used to talk about carbon nanotubes, and carbon nanotubes was being explored for a variety of applications. And then in recent times, you know, for the past 10, 15 years already, people have been working in the area of graphene. And it's a two-dimensional material, which is supposed to show new pathways towards a variety of applications. They are supposed to be strong, flexible. They are supposed to be transparent, conducting, and so on. And in fact, they are supposed to have such kind of applications that people are thinking of using them for the next generation electronic devices, and people are even thinking of sewing them onto clothing, slapped onto drink bottles, and so on. So you may see graphene in many forms, and the graphene may come to its existence, and even common layman people can see graphene in many places. That could be the possibility in the next few years. And the European Union allotted more than 1 billion euros to graphene, to get graphene out of the lab, which means the European Union has pumped a lot of money to make sure that graphene it just doesn't remain in the lab, but sees applications in all sorts of life. So if you look at the summary of this graphene applications, you can see that they can be used in solar panels, they can be used in mobile phones. You can see someday a mobile phone like this, a completely transparent mobile phone, something which is like this, and can be used in prosthetics, flexible screens. In fact, even when, I mean, as early as 15 years back or 20 years back when I was doing my PhD, some of the Swiss scientists were working on flexible screens at that time. So that you can simply fold your mobile phone like a piece of cloth and keep it in your pocket and go. So that's the kind of technology that people are looking at. So graphene is supposed to be one of the wonder materials which can see a variety of applications. And it's very interesting. So I wanted to show this slide simply to tell you that discoveries happen many times accidentally. And Andrei Geim and Konstantin Novoselov, both of them from Manchester University, in fact, when they discovered graphene, it was an accident. What they were doing is when they were just playing around with the scotch tape, the cello tape that you know, and when they just put a piece of scotch tape on a lump of graphite, they were able to get one layer thick carbon atoms. I mean, a layer thick of carbon atoms, which eventually turned out to be graphene and the two-dimensional form of graphite. So they got the Nobel Prize in 2010, exactly 11 years back, for their discovery of this two-dimensional graphene. And you now know that during the last 11, 12 years, people have been extensively working on graphene. And UK has awarded more than 60 million pounds and established the National Graphene Institute in UK, so that again, people are, you know, thinking about bringing graphene out of the lab, so that they can see some really practical applications. Another interesting material which Guardian reported is stannin, you know, very similar, like a brother of graphene. And stannin is a material which was envisaged in the laboratory using computational experiments. And people thought that stannin could replace silicon as a cheap and abundant material from which you can make computer chips. And the interesting thing about stannin is it's an insulator on the inside and conductor on the outside. If you see the schematic shown here, it is the red line here shows you know, conduction, and it is insulated within it. So it's again a one layer one atomic layer thick tin, and where it is expected to conduct electricity 100% with 100% efficiency. So, in fact, Stannion is pitched to be a natural successor to copper interconnects in computers at some point of time. So it may not have come out to that extent, but people are extensively working on this topic. In fact, when I was in Germany a couple of years back, people were thinking about, in fact, they are also called as topological insulators. And people are thinking that at some point of time, this field could get a Nobel Prize at some point of time. So this is one of the, wonder material that people are thinking of. And the question is whether this two-dimensional tin, whether it can become a super material. It is something that people are exploring. The third wonder material that Guardian has reported is a class of materials called metamaterials. And it's, again, a very interesting class of materials where people are thinking about controlling electrons inside the materials to the extent that see how electrons can be controlled to see to that how it when they respond to electromagnetic radiation. So which means that it is possible to develop materials which can be the electrons inside those materials can be manipulated to the extent where it can be invisible for some of the electromagnetic radiations. So one of the pioneering groups in Imperial College in physics department, they are working on understanding the structure of this material on a length scale that's extremely short compared to the wavelength that you are interested in, so that you can actually make a material invisible for a particular wavelength. So that is why you can see on the right hand side, I have put a schematic which is called invisible cloak. That is, you can make the material invisible for a particular radiation, electromagnetic radiation. So this is again something very new that people have started to work on and can have a host of applications, including defense applications. Another interesting topic, which again our Guardian reports, is silk. I think you may not have heard of this material. In fact, when I saw this article 4 years back, even it was new to me. It is very similar to silk because it is made from leftover shrimps and proteins derived from silk. So therefore, the material is named as silk. This is being developed in the Weiss Institute at Harvard University. And the objective here is to make materials from understanding what happens in nature. So most of us know that the exoskeleton of many of the insects is very hard. Like, for example, you could see, the immediate example that I can think of is tortoise. The tortoise, the exoskeleton of tortoise is extremely hard and tough. Like that, you can see many such insects where the exoskeleton is hard. So people are trying to understand that and trying to artificially biomimic such kind of materials derived from nature. And that has led to an entirely new discovery, new class of materials research called bio-inspired materials research. And people have been working on such bio-inspired materials research around the world. In fact, Harvard has some of the top scientists who work on biomaterials, bio-inspired materials research, developing technologies based on biomaterials, taking inspiration from nature. In fact, one such experiment, we also did at some point of time is to do surface engineering using bio-inspired materials research. You can see many of these plants are extremely super hydrophobic, apart from lotus leaf. In fact, lotus leaf, many of you know that it is super hydrophobic, but there are many other plants which are also super hydrophobic. Euphorbia mellifera is a decorative plant. Moringa oleifera is nothing but drumstick leaves. So all of them have a super hydrophobic surface. A super hydrophobic surface is a surface where the contact angle of the water droplet is more than 150 degrees. So if you put a water droplet, it simply flows off. It doesn't stay, it doesn't stick to the surface. And such surfaces are very important. Imagine if you have such a kind of a surface on the windshield of a car, or imagine you have such a surface on the window panes or window panels of your house. So you can make sure that dirt and dust do not accumulate on the surfaces. So people did try to understand how it happens in nature, and they have tried to biomimic it, for example. And this is one example of a pond skater resting on the surface of water. Some of you might have seen in, semi-urban areas or villages where you have seen such pond skaters on water surfaces, where it floats on water. It can actually lie on water. Basically, people have noted that they too have super hydrophobic feet. And people have realized that it is possible to take these lessons from nature to engineering applications. I mean, we are engineers. We want to see how do we understand the nature to make sure that the understanding is translated to engineering applications. So people have used such understanding of bio-inspired surface engineering to windmills, so that you have such kind of coatings on these turbine blades, so that the drag is limited to a large extent. The efficiency is very high. You can have such a self-cleaning paint on some of the facades, so that you can have a self-cleaning wall. Or for that matter, you can even have such coatings on racing boats, so that the friction that the water offers to the boat is minimized to a large extent. In fact, we were working on this for quite some time, providing ceramic coatings on some of the boats, racing boats, so that the friction is minimized to a large extent. So materials research is very interesting. So I stop at those five wonder materials that the Guardian reported, but I would like you to take you through some of the very important industries where materials research plays a very important role. Let me start with aerospace industry, because I myself worked for ISRO Satellite Center for about 3 years before going to Germany for my PhD, and I am fascinated by the challenges, materials challenges that involves in aerospace industries. Let me take the example of a gas turbine engine. What you see here on the left hand side is a gas turbine engine. The gas turbine engine is the heart of any flight. If you don't have a gas turbine, you cannot fly. So every aircraft will have a gas turbine. And in fact, I don't know how many of you know, the gas turbine research establishment in Bangalore is actually responsible for designing and developing such a gas turbine. In fact, India has not been so greatly successful in making such a gas turbine. We are still struggling. Although we have understanding on propulsion technology, but gas turbine technology has been a very tough exercise for us. So most of the aircrafts in India, that is why outsourced. I mean, you import them. There are many aerospace companies which actually make such turbines, like Pratt & Whitney, Rolls-Royce, and GE, and so on. But the material challenges are huge. In India as well, we are working on such materials. They typically have single crystal blades. Again, a technological challenge to make single crystal blades. And then single crystal blades are made up of nickel-based superalloys, and they melt at around 1200 degrees Celsius. So that means if the material is going to melt at 1200 degrees Celsius, you cannot operate beyond 800 or 900 degrees Celsius. So although combustion in the engine, you can always increase temperature. If you increase temperature, the efficiency increases. But you cannot simply keep on increasing the temperature, because there is a limitation of the material, whether the material can withstand such temperatures or not. So therefore, these nickel-based superalloys are coated with multi-layer coatings. They're called thermal barrier coatings. And if you put these multi-layer coatings, on which actually the top coat is made of a ceramic coating called zirconia, then you can take it to much higher temperatures. And if you realize much higher temperatures in the engine can become much more efficient. And this is again a technological challenge, and I would say it's a material technology challenge. In fact, again, I will go back to my PhD days. There was a multi-institutional consortium at that time where they were developing such thermal barrier coatings on nickel-based superalloy blades. And people are now working on environmental barrier coatings for such single crystal blades. Again, a very technological challenge that we, as material scientists, that we have to undergo or we have to face. So this is one of the important challenges that I wanted to bring it to your notice. And there are many such, very harsh, extremely harsh applications where people work on replacing even metal bearings with ceramic bearings, or some of the exhaust walls made up of zirconia and so on. And some of these ceramic rotors are made up of, silicon nitride and so on. Extremely difficult. Just imagine such complex geometries which are made using ceramics. So the challenges are enormous. And one of the other challenges that I would like to take you through is the semiconductor industry, because most of us use computers, laptops, and so on. I go back 20 years back when I was using my laptop. If it gets heated up, it used to immediately shut down. And nowadays, most of the laptops are designed in such a way that the heat dissipation is very good. So electronics produce heat in the system, electronic systems. and this heat has to be driven away. And one of the companies in Germany called Ceramtec, this picture is taken from the company Ceramtec. So they produce this so-called chip-on heat sink technology, where you increase the surface area, at the same time use appropriate materials, which has a very high thermal conductivity, and build the chip on this heat sink. And so this ceramic with very high surface area acts as the heat sink, and then the electronics are protected from heat accumulation, and therefore they can work for a longer duration without any major problems. So this is one of the very nice challenges that you can think of in the semiconductor industry. And most of you might have again gone to a dentist and might have actually got a crown of zirconia or whatever in your teeth if you had a decay in your tooth. Otherwise, in former times, people used to use metallic caps. Now you can use zirconia caps so that you can completely mask the fact that you have an artificial cap on your tooth. So this is all possible because of the development in materials technology. So people have been using, developing materials technology to an extent where people have started to realize even in their daily lives. I'm now showing one of the extremely challenging application where you can see a completely transparent ceramic. And this is an extremely challenging task. It is produced by the Fraunhofer Institute in Germany. And I think not many people can produce this in India. Not many people can produce this in India even now. And these can be used for ballistic applications. That is, it can be used as armors in the tanks. And it can be used as inspection windows. A technology which can attract a lot of attention and extremely useful for the country. So again, this involves materials research. It involves, of course, understanding of basic materials science, at the same time moving from basic understanding to technological development. And most of you again have gone in cars, automobiles, and so on. And I don't know how many of you know that you need a catalyst which can actually make sure that the exhaust gases are purified to a large extent. So people use these cordierite honeycombs with catalysts so that the exhaust gas is purified to a large extent, which you may not know. Again, this is a challenge to make these materials have embed catalysts in them and produce these highly porous structures so that the exhaust gases pass through these filters and they undergo catalysis and make sure that the contaminants are degraded and then the environment is protected. And again, on the left-hand side, I show you one of the, again, very newer developments with respect to the brake disc. Again, it's a ceramic brake disc. People who are exploring to use ceramic brake disc. In fact, sometime back, I was working on a cast iron brake disc from one of the companies in Chennai. They make a cast iron brake disc. I was working on the distortion problem of that brake disc. So people are now looking at brake discs which are ceramic-based so that they offer significant weight reduction. So it's all about, you know, when you talk about automotive industry or an aerospace industry, it's always the materials challenge that limit their, to realize its fullest potential. People do not want, heavy bike or a heavy car. People do not want an aircraft. You need to reduce the weight as much as possible so that the fuel efficiency is increased to a large extent. And that's where the materials play a very important role. So this example on the left-hand side is to show you that at some point of time you will see such kind of ceramic brake disc being used in automotives. In fact, some of the high-end cars in Germany already have started to use them. In fact, when I was in Germany again a couple of years back, I was looking at some of those ceramic brake discs that some of the high-end cars of BMW and Mercedes-Benz are using such kind of ceramic discs. And now that you know, we are our department, most of the metallurgical and metals engineering departments in IITs, they all have metallurgy in them because metallurgy is a very ancient subject. In fact, India has a significant contribution in the field of metallurgy. So you cannot get away with metallurgy. In fact, metallurgy has a lot to do with Indian industry. So we need to have the word metallurgy. And I just wanted to show you this. I'm just completing 30 minutes, so I just want to give you this last example of this world's tallest statue. I think you have heard of it. This is the statue of Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel, the first Home Minister of India. It is the double the size of height of the Statue of Liberty in the US. This was inaugurated by the Honorable Prime Minister of India, you might have seen on the television, built by Larsen & Toubro. And if you look at this this entire, the way this statue has been built, it is simply an engineering marvel. In fact, if you, of course, there are a lot of design challenges and so on, but one of the challenges that I would like to bring it to your notice is welding. In fact, many of the times when people talk about welding and casting, people may not get attracted to them, to those topics immediately. But how will somebody build such a statue if you didn't have expertise in welding? In fact, at IIT Madras, for example, there are a lot of people who are working on welding topics. And now people are moving from welding topics and going to a very similar topic in terms of scientific understanding, but something which has to do with modern manufacturing technique called additive manufacturing. So welding is a more fundamental aspect, and additive manufacturing is a much more, I would say, a modern way of welding of materials. And now you can see additive manufacturing is a very hot topic in the field of metallurgical and materials engineering, which is used for metals, alloys, and ceramics. So I just wanted to highlight that both metallurgy and materials research are important, and they do play a very vital role in nation development. As far as opportunities are concerned for metallurgists and material scientists, I have to say that most of our students join the defense DRDO labs, like Defense Metallurgical Research Lab in Hyderabad, or DRDL or Naval Materials Research Lab in Ambernath in Pune, or maybe DMSRD in Kanpur. So there are a lot of DRDO labs who are very keen on hiring metallurgists. Of course, ISRO has its own materials research program. Like, for example, Vikram Sarabhai Space Center hires a lot of people with materials background, and Atomic Energy Institutions hire a lot of metallurgists. Many of our students have joined Baba Atomic Research Center or IGCAR, Indira Gandhi Center for Atomic Research in Kalpakkam, which is very close to Chennai. So whether you talk of atomic energy, space, aerospace, or defense, I think metallurgists and material scientists have a very wide role to play. And as far as the public sector units and private sectors are concerned, the Midhani Mishra Dhatu Nigam Limited, again, a public sector unit, which produces alloys for many of the strategic sectors. ERCI is a DST-governed organization, again, which is located in Hyderabad. BHEL, again, hires a lot of metallurgists. As far as the private companies are concerned, there are now a lot of private companies which look for metallurgists. Tata Steel, of course. Tata Steel hires metallurgists from almost all the IITs, and there are a lot of metallurgists from IITs who have led Tata Steel. General Electric in Bangalore hires a lot of material scientists. And Pratt and I just put a logo of Pratt and Whitney. It's again an aerospace company, which is again located in Bangalore, which hires material scientists and metallurgists. There are many other companies like Rolls-Royce, Honeywell, and so on. I didn't get time to put all of them. All of them look for quality material scientists and metallurgists to hire them. And not last but not the least, I always feel that one need not look for only jobs, somebody to offer you a job. You should also look at incubation. And this is an era of incubation, startup, and entrepreneurship. Some time back when we all graduated, that possibility was not there, but it's possible right now. And what you see on the left-hand side is the IIT Madras Research Park and IIT Bombay. I think this is a science park of IIT Bombay. The idea is to innovate and incubate. We want young engineers who graduate from IITs come with their own ideas and start companies. And there are a lot of people who are willing to fund them. And now I already see a lot of students who graduate after their, BTech in metallurgy, starting their own companies. And I think the era of waiting for a company to hire them, and that's gone. I think people are taking the plunge and incubating their own companies. And that's really a nice thing, because that's how the country grows. When the intellectual property is developed, and when intellectual property is translated to technology, and when this technology is sold for money. And that's how India or the country progresses. For people who would like to continue in the field, there are several opportunities, of course. Many of our students go to top US graduate schools. At least I know from IIT Madras, it's very common to go the top 5% of them usually go to MIT, Stanford, or Harvard, and so on, to the US graduate schools. Not many people knew about the European universities, but I mean, from the time I joined, in fact, I was one of the very few who joined with a PhD from Europe in IIT Madras. After that, there are many faculty members who have joined with a European degree. So nowadays, I see a lot of people going to European universities, Max Planck Institutes, for example. There are a lot of Max Planck Institutes in Germany with specific focus on certain fields. Like, you know, if you want to work on steels, people go to Max Planck Institute for iron research in Düsseldorf. If you want to do materials research, you go to Stuttgart, Max Planck Institute in Stuttgart. If you want to do you know, something on polymers, you go to Max Planck Institute in Mainz in Germany. So there are many you know, specific focus areas where you could go and study further. I mean, not only in Germany, there are other good universities. Like, for example, EPFL is a Swiss Federal Institute of Technology in Lausanne in Switzerland. I mean, I didn't put all of them, but you know, there are a host of universities, at very top schools in Europe where you could study further. You know, after your undergraduate degree, do a master's degree or a, you know, take a doctoral degree in those universities, and either settle down there, working in some companies, or return back to India. Because I think most of the IITs would like to have PhDs, material scientists with PhDs, good material scientists whom we would like them to join IITs as professors and do some quality work. And thank you so much. I think I will stop here, and I would like to take questions. And I would like to stop by saying that metallurgists have led the nation. And at this point of time, I should certainly mention one person, that is Manohar Parikar, who was our former defense minister, late Manohar Parikar. And, he was a metallurgist and alumnus of IIT Bombay. And so we should remember him at this point of time because he did a great job. And then and then many of the atomic energy institutions have been led by metallurgists. And I think with this, I will stop here. And I would like to take questions. So this was just a snapshot of what the field can offer, the exciting field can offer to people. So I'll stop here. So if there are any questions, I'd like to take them.
Oh, yeah. Thank you so much, Professor Kumar, for such an insightful talk. Like, you have almost covered all the things, and mostly the questions which were asked, they are answered, but still I'll ask you some of the questions which were asked put in here. So one of them was asking, what will be the effect of IIDD in metal? Yeah,
the IIDD programs were introduced basically to give a flavor of two, three departments together, coming together and offering courses. For example, in IIT Madras, we have IIDD program on data analytics. So obviously certain fields cannot be taught by one single department. It requires several departments to come together and offer a course. Now, for example, IIT Madras is starting a new course on electric vehicles. So we are also involved in that. And electric vehicle, for example, is the next generation vehicles that you will see on the roads. And electric vehicles obviously cannot be taught by one single discipline. You require, when you talk about electric vehicles, it involves battery technology, it involves materials, it involves distortion engineering, it involves design. So obviously you require people from different departments to come together and offer a specialized course on those topics. So these fields would specialize people in certain domains and make them fit to go to a certain class of industries. So IIDD program are specialized programs offered by jointly by different departments, which otherwise would not have been possible to be offered. And they are good. I think they are good. For example, IIDD program on data analytics has a huge demand in the industry. IIDD program in electric vehicles has a huge demand in the industry. So industry is coming forward. In IIT Madras, for example, IIDD program on electric vehicles is led by Ashok Leyland. The senior vice president of Ashok Leyland has himself come forward to ask IITs to offer this course. So it is led by the industry.
Most of the students were having questions on the future prospects, but you have already covered them. But even still, if students have some doubt, they can ask to unmute themselves. And one more thing was about the curriculum. Like, Will they be able to explore other interests? Okay, fine. This is has already been covered in I20, I guess, right?
Yeah. So most of the curriculums are available in the department website of other IITs. For some reasons, if the website is not working or whatever, you can always write to the head of the department, and the head of the department should be able to send you the curriculum in case the website is not working for whatever reasons. I'll answer one question about is there any difference between metallurgical engineering or material science and so on. It is a historical thing. Most of the departments were initially called only Department of Metallurgy or Department of Metallurgical Engineering, because metallurgy is a historically, I would say, it's an old word. And most of the departments were named as metallurgy or metallurgical engineering to begin with. But with time, what happened is that many of them realized that you cannot just have metallurgy, because it will simply exclude fields like polymers, ceramics, and other fields. So people wanted to go beyond conventional metallurgy, and therefore to incorporate other fields of materials engineering, people changed their names. Many of the IITs changed their names from metallurgical, just metallurgy, to metallurgical and materials engineering. And some of them even wanted to remove metallurgy, but it was not, as I said, it's not really possible, because India still has a requirement of metallurgists. I think only IIT Kanpur has named it as material science and engineering. Otherwise, most of the other IITs still retain the name metallurgy in their department. However, Indian Institute of Science has changed its name to Department of Metallurgy to Materials Engineering, because now they don't do much of metallurgy, is what I would say. But most of the other IITs are still doing a lot of metallurgy. So it doesn't mean, it doesn't matter much. It's only a department policy, and that particular IIT might have changed its name slightly, but the curriculum would not vary too much, is my feeling.
Okay, sir. And just in the same way, that there was one more question, but the difference between ceramics and metallurgy, like.
Oh, yeah. Most of the IITs may not be offering any ceramic BTEC degree, if I'm right.
Yeah.
But there are some universities which offer ceramic technology and so on. For example, some of the NITs have a separate branch in ceramic engineering, and I know some of the universities have a separate branch in ceramic engineering. But if you are doing a bachelor's in ceramic engineering, obviously it's only about ceramics. And if you join metallurgy and materials engineering, then ceramics just is one part of it. I may have given more examples of ceramic technologies in my slide, because I am a ceramic scientist. I gave more examples of that, but otherwise you could also find several examples in metallurgy which are very important and relevant.
And so
I will answer one question on this, how IITs are different from IISc.
Yeah.
I will tell you, there are major differences between IISc and IITs. I did my master's in IISc and I'm now a professor in IIT. There's a big difference. IITs are supposed to be more technology oriented. So we would like people to become engineers. We encourage people to become entrepreneurs. We encourage people to incubate. And we focus more on technology development. And most of the IIT, and IITs also have a very strong undergraduate program. If you look at all the IITs, you have a very, very strong undergraduate program. And we are very well connected with the alumni of who graduated with an undergraduate degree from IITs. Our program is mostly, of course, in former times was more tuned towards undergraduate programs, but now it has been extended to an extent where it can accommodate both masters and other research students as well. IISc is more science focused, because Indian Institute of Science is a science institute. They may not dwell too much on engineering and technology. But I would consider IITs are more fun. Not because I am from IIT, but I have realized IIT is more fun than IISc. I mean, if you want to study in IIT, please go ahead and join in IIT. You will like it.
Okay. And sir, I may ask Pradeep also to unmute himself so that he can ask this question.
Yes, sir. Actually, I had the same question. I had asked the question about IISc and IITs. Sir, this is because I have got admission into both, I am interested in both, but I do not have a strong interest for any one specific IIT or IISc. So I was a bit confused.
I am possibly biased, but I strongly advise you to join any of these IITs. IIT Bombay is great, IIT Madras is great, IIT Kanpur is great. All the older IITs at least have been to all these older IITs. You will have a very enjoyable time. And 4 years of your undergraduation in IITs will be an eye-opener for you. And you will remember me after 4 years, you'll come back to me and say that, you will agree with me 100%. IIC is, of course, I'm not saying that IIC is a bad place. IIC is a very research-focused place. But I feel that you will miss the overall, overall development in IIC. For example, most of these IITs have, technical festivals, cultural festivals. And for example, we have science parks and research parks. You can think of incubation. I think the opportunities are really huge. And IITs also have a very strong alumni network. And you will realize the importance of alumni network at a later stage of your life. Between IITs and IISc, straight away go to IITs. Choose one of the best IITs and you will not regret it.
All right, so that was the last of the questions in the interest of time as well. So I would like to give you a very big thank you for taking the precious time out of your packed schedule and helping the students out. And so now I would like to hand over to Nav.
Thank you. It was great talking to all of you.
For joining us. It was very nice interacting with you. And the talk was also very insightful. And I must say that our students must have had a very wonderful time hearing to you. And you quite cleared very, very, very trivial doubts of them also. Like that's something which arises during the counseling period. So once again, on behalf of the entire TechFest team, I would like to thank you for taking time out of your busy schedule and helping us out in our initiative. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you for inviting me. It was a pleasure being with all of you. And please visit IIT Madras when situation permits. You will enjoy the forest campus of IIT Madras.
Yeah. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Pleasure to have you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.